Let's take a look at how capacitors and inductors combine in series and in parallel. I'd like to start off with capacitors in series. My target here is to replace two capacitors in series with a single equivalent capacitor that will not change the voltages and the currents elsewhere in the circuit. I want to start off with a geometrical argument. We know that each capacitor consists of two plates separated by a certain distance. For the sake of this argument, let's assume that the surface areas of the plates on each capacitor are the same. The distance between the plates for capacitor C1 can be denoted as D1, and the distance between the plates on capacitor C2 can be denoted as D2. If I imagine slowly bringing these two capacitors towards one another, then I would reach a point where the wire length combining those two capacitors is zero. At that point, we would effectively end up with two plates separated by a distance D1 plus D2. As you might recall, the formula for capacitance is epsilon, the strength of the dielectric, times the surface area, divided by the distance between the two plates. If I take the reciprocal of my equation for the equivalent capacitance, then I wind up with a formula for the equivalent capacitance in terms of capacitances C1 and C2. This was the geometrical argument. I now want to give an argument in terms of currents and voltages, which will give us the same result. Since replacing the set of two capacitors with an effective capacitor will not change the voltage and current around the set, I'll go ahead and label it in the circuit and we'll force it to be unchanged. Let's call the voltage across the set of two to be V, and let's call the voltage across our equivalent capacitor to be the same V. Let's assume that we have current I flowing into this set, and we'll assume that the same current I flows through our equivalent capacitor. Our voltage V will divide into two different voltages, V1 and V2. For each of these capacitors, let's use the relationship between current and voltage to try to see if we can combine them. The current through a capacitor is related to the change in the voltage across its plates. The same formula holds for our effective capacitance. From the diagram on the left, I can see that V equals V1 plus V2. Let's take the derivative with respect to time. From this formula, I can see that dV by dt is the current divided by my effective capacitance. I can make a similar conclusion about dV1 by dt, and likewise about dV2 by dt. The current I cancels from the formula, and we're left with the same equation. Since the formula for capacitors in series is equivalent to the formula for resistors in parallel, I can use the same tricks that we learned for resistors in parallel to combine capacitors in series numerically. In this example, we have two 500 microfarad capacitors in series. Let's divide by two to find the equivalent capacitance. Here, the answer for the effective capacitance is 250 microfarads. Let's now take a look at capacitors in parallel and see how they can be combined. I'll give both a geometrical argument and an argument related to the current and voltage. Let's assume that capacitor C1 has a surface area on its plates of A1. The formula for capacitance is then epsilon times that surface area divided by the distance between the two plates. I'm going to assume that the distance between the two plates for each of the other two capacitors is the same as that of C1. But let's assume that the surface areas are different. I'll call the surface area for capacitor C2 A2, and I'll call the surface area for capacitor C3 A3. Our goal is to find an equivalent capacitor. We could imagine bringing all three of these capacitors nearby one another. What would we be left with geometrically? Well, we would end up with a single capacitor with a large surface area, A1 plus A2 plus A3. The formula for our effective capacitance is epsilon times the total surface area divided by the distance between the plates. By comparison with the formulas on the left, I can see that the effective capacitance is just the sum of three individual capacitances that I started off with. Let's now think about the current and voltage. My goal here is to find an effective capacitance that preserves the relationship between current and voltage of the set. Since these three capacitors are in parallel with one another, they have the same voltage drop across them. The current, however, will be different. Let's call this current I1, let's call this current I2, and let's call this current I3. Let's go ahead and write down the formulas relating current and voltage for each of these capacitors. Let's now apply the Kirchhoff current law to this node in the circuit. Current I equals the sum of the three individual currents. I can eliminate all the currents from this equation. My conclusion is that capacitors in parallel add. For this particular example, the effective capacitance is 1500 microfarads. Let's take a look at inductors in series, and I'd like to start off here with a geometrical argument on why these numbers have to add. The formula for inductance is related to mu, the magnetic permeability, in the number of turns of wire wrapped around the coil, A, the surface area enclosed by the coil, and H, the height of the coil. For the sake of this argument, let's assume that these two inductors are identical. If I position these two coils close to one another, we can imagine them forming a single coil. What would it look like? Well, if we don't alter the geometry of each individual inductor, and we merely push them together, then the height would be twice what it was before. Furthermore, the number of turns on the new equivalent inductor would be twice the number of turns on each individual inductor. Let's use the formula now to find the inductance of our equivalent inductor. Mu, the magnetic permeability, is just a constant. We now have 2n turns, and we need to square that. Our surface area A is the same, and our height is now twice what it was before. My conclusion here is that the inductances should add. Now, I know we've not really seen this formula before, but it should be clear that the inductance of an inductor should depend on its geometry. And we've shown here that when you combine two inductors together, the geometry changes in such a way that the inductance should add. In this particular example, the effective inductance is 2 millihenries, but let me give another argument relating current and voltage. We know that the current and the voltage need to be preserved when we replace the two inductors in series with an equivalent inductance. Let's call the voltage across inductor L1, V1, and let's call the other voltage V2. I know that these voltages have to add. Furthermore, I know a relationship between voltage and current for each inductor that I've drawn. I can substitute in for each of these voltages. I'm left with the conclusion that inductors in series add. Let's move on to inductors in parallel. I'm not going to make a geometrical argument in this case because the current divides, which then changes the flux linkage in each inductor. I couldn't think of a good geometrical argument to show how inductors in parallel need to combine. Let's make an argument purely on the voltage and current considerations. We know that the voltage is going to be the same across each of these three inductors because they're all in parallel with one another. The current divides into three branches. Let's call this branch I1, let's call this branch I2, and let's call this branch I3. I know the formula relating voltage and current in each of these three cases. We know that the current splits into three branches. Let's take the derivative of the current then. I can substitute for the derivative of the current using each of the formulas for voltage that I've already written. My conclusion is that inductors in parallel combine similarly to resistors in parallel. In this particular example, let's first combine L1 and L2 numerically. That should give us 0.5 millihenry. Combining again, I can multiply in the numerator and add in the denominator. I'm left with 0.33 millihenry. As the numerical result here. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.